10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Complexities turn to bad.
Hello and welcome back, everybody, to the Summit for North American Qualifiers. We're going to be taking a look at Game 3 here. Get hype, ladies and gentlemen. Complexity versus Cloud9. Battle of the Giants here in the lower bracket. The loser of this one is going to have to go home. The winner goes on to play tomorrow. Digital Chaos, which should be an absolutely fantabulous game.
Reserve time.
21 hours and 20 minutes from now is going to be the time. The winner of that goes on to play Root Gaming for the final spot on Friday in the December Summit 4. So absolutely excited about this one, and we're seeing a couple of different things. I'm at Lyrical Dota, joined today by at Llama Down Under. Anything you see here that surprises you from the very beginning?
Alk feels like he hasn't been a first round ban for a little bit. A lot of teams kind of favoring other heroes over him. Complexity do have the first pick out of the ban phase, so that's why they were letting the Doom go through. And Cloud9 now needs to decide. We just say whoever has the Doom wins the game.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, I don't know. They let it through there. Lich is going to be what they opt to ban out. That is something that every single time Complexity have prioritized, and that leaves open the Doom. So, question
no
is...
No surprises there on what was the first pick. Although, what's his name? Doxia is through, who hasn't gotten through in a while. He's often banned as well.
Yeah, that's something interesting. And with Cloud9's propensity, or sort of, that's not even a word, with the fact that Cloud9 like to pick Ember Spirit, that's what I was trying to say. The combo there of Darkseer, Ember Spirit is always something. Propensity, that's the word.
Yeah, I was like, oh, you were close, don't worry, go on it.
But with them liking to pick Ember, the Darkseer Ember combo is always on point, and you can fight early with it. Although that being said, Cloud9 doesn't really, they haven't been the type of team that have wanted to take a ton of early engagements. They felt comfortable in their ability to face off against Complexity in the late stages of this game. So we'll see how they end up doing. Doom last game was a huge impact, and able to roam around and get a couple of kills on Chessie, along with that Rubick Leshrac combo. So there's Mr. Man, Darkseer through.
We have a really a difference in styles when it comes to Complexity and Cloud9. It does feel like often Complexity does draft for a bit more of an earlier game peak, and we'll see this as well. There are teams like E-Wolves. E-Wolves drafts 100% always for the early game, picking heroes like Chen and Enchantress that just, Enchantress a bit more than Chen, but they're heroes that are meant to fight early and win the game early. And then I think the other extreme is Root Gaming often picks stuff like Medusa and Spectre, and you're like, okay guys, we're in for another 70-minute game. Complexity kind of picked for that mid-game lineup, and Cloud9 now with the Darkseer Gyro, I think they're off to a great start to, if Complexity does pick up a strong carry, you just make a copy of it with your Darkseer.
Yeah, certainly, why not? It's a great little combo there, being able to toss that on out, and I think the other thing is, it's such a strong teamfight lineup already at the start here. Darkseer Vacuum into Calldown is always going to be able to just decimate the enemy team. And I think that if Complexity don't start picking some of these heroes that can deal with this, maybe combo breakers a la Silent Thrall, I don't think we're going to be seeing them in the first page, or at least double down on the amount of damage that you can deal out in an AoE a la the Queen of Pain, then you're going to be in a situation where they can potentially just get rolled over by the five man of Cloud9 that's coming out. But I like this Queen of Pain pick. It did make it through, and they're going to take it second for Chessie, I'm assuming.
Yeah, Chessie showed he knows his way around this hero. Also really nice against both the Darkseer and the Gyro. It's something where if you can get up that early Orchid, you silence either of those heroes, they'd no longer have an escape mechanism or a way of punishing you for blinking in so close, because often as the Queen of Pain, if you blink out of position, it's 15 second cooldown at level 1, the Gyrocopter will kill you in that time, but if you have your Orchid up, you can blow him up instead.
Yeah, totally. And I wonder if we're going to be seeing some of those defensive supports to help deal with that for the Gyrocopter. That's always my response whenever I see, you know, a lot of burst damage coming out against this Gyro, is to sort of go scale it back a little bit, go for that Dazzle, a little bit of that safer pick. To me, that hero was just so good and didn't make it through, I think, each of the games so far between these two. Hasn't made it through to the second round of picks. And we'll see if Complexity opt to ban it out. Already taking out of the pool the Ancient Apparition. and mind games abound. I mean, I think about these matchups, and it's just, they know each other so well. They know what they're comfortable with. I like what we're seeing so far. And actually, Cloud9 are the ones that ban out the Winter Wyvern.
They have to. With the AA banned out, I think Complexity making it clear that they're going to pick up. Well, there are two things going on here. AA always hurts the Scorched Earth, but I think Cloud9 understanding Complexity wouldn't ban out the AA just for the Scorched Earth. They probably have another hero in mind. Maybe it's the Undying, maybe it's the Dazzle, maybe it's the Wyvern. I would love to see Complexity ban out the AA, maybe get their hands on one of those other heroes, and then just go for the Huskar pick, because they do have the last pick before the ban phase, so they can definitely, with that very last pick, grab the Huskar and make sure that they aren't locked down in another way. And Beastmaster ban out could be a sneaky way of also saying that they don't want to deal with their Huskar being locked down, although Beastmaster maybe just Complexity saying don't make her Queen of Pain unable to fly.
Yeah, no, I think that either one of those is, it deals with either of those heroes really well, and given the dynamic and the emotions coming into this, that's something else that can't be understated, is how much each of these teams want to just destroy the enemy completely and totally. I think that it would make sense to try and go for something like a sort of semi-last pick Huskar. The Tusk is going to be banned out. They also are going to be able to take the Slaughter off the back of this. So a hero that can deal somewhat well with the Huskar, has a nice stun, has the amp damage there. Yeah, maybe a little bit of a semblance of being able to deal with it without needing to necessarily commit hardcore to some other type of pure damage.
If I were Complexity, I'd totally just go Dazzle Huskar right away, and Dazzle, there it is. And now if Cloud9 doesn't pick it, I don't actually know if Complexity will go for the Huskar. I should pull that up and check what their Huskar picking rate is, because there are some teams that you, like, you see E-Wolves pick up a Dazzle and you just ban the Huskar, because they do this all the time. But I do not know Complexity's record, and I'll try to pull that up as we're speaking. But yeah, it feels really hard. Warlock, some lockdown, as you said, Slaughter, physical damage, but Gyro, all of his magic damage, your Huskar doesn't super care about that.
Yeah, this is... Oh, I think that they're trying to figure out if they want to do it or not. Of course, the Golems, they can potentially... I mean, the biggest thing is just that long-duration stun that you end up getting out of this, which is pretty great. But I don't know. I'm a little bit concerned about Complexity, the ability to lock down heroes. Like, they have a lot of damage, they've got a lot of sustain with Dazzle, but the only real thing that they have right now to lock anybody down is Doom, which, while it is a great spell for being able to keep somebody from casting on out those abilities, obviously, it isn't a lockdown necessarily. It's more of a lockdown for heroes that have escape mechanisms like the Blink. So everybody else can kind of just run away from it and potentially get healed up. I don't know. I feel like they need something more here, maybe. And potentially trying to think if they want to go for something like that Huskar, maybe something a little bit more lockdown-centric.
It's entirely possible, as you said, the Slaughter, the Huskar is a bit too greedy. They need more lockdown. Maybe something like a Sven instead, also a good counter to the Slaughter from the perspective of the Warcry will buff you up, and definitely benefits from having a Dazzle around. You can play a bit more ham, so not a bad pickup there, and I wouldn't be surprised to see that. They could also try for some sort of farming co-op TA being run or whatever they're comfortable with, but yeah, Complexity, still a lot of options, and as you said, you kind of want lockdown. You need now a carry that brings something else to the party, and they're running out of time.
Yeah, 10 seconds left, just about, and they have really been stumped to a large extent by this Warlock. Do you think that Queen of Pain against Warlock is a matchup that, oh my goodness, all right, that's what we're doing now.
Okay, this is really interesting and almost questionable. Drow here, you already talked about the Golems. Drow, you don't want people to get up in your face. Slaughter, you know, is going to build a Blink. Gyrocopter will probably have a Sand and Yasha and the ability to run at you, although you can always try to silence him. Dogsia has Surge. This Drow feels a bit like a bad pick, and I'm kind of wondering, as you said, what is their next support to tie it all together for Complexity to make this okay?
What if this is a Z-Freak Drow?
Okay. So, yeah. I think that there has been in competitive Dota before a support Drow run. I really doubt we'll see it just because she does better elsewhere, but it's certainly a possibility. Like, it makes it really hard to value the aura, though.
Right. No, that's the thing that's so weird about this is if you talk about what Complexity want to do in this game, they want to win their lanes hard. That's consistently been the motif. I agree with you that I think the more likely option is going to be the Drow Ranger in that carry role with Doom in the offlane, Dazzle Bean keeping that Drow alive, but there's still always the potential there lingering in the back of your head that with all of this weird stuff that we've been seeing, Korlock coming on back, maybe they end up running that. I don't know. It doesn't seem entirely plausible, but Gust is a pretty good silence and decent at being able to deal with some of these heroes. The extra damage coming on out, I don't know. I think you're probably right that it's going to be a Drow in the safe lane, but my heart goes out for the Drow support.
It's always interesting to experiment. Not quite sure if they want to do it here. As you said, this is a whoever loses goes home. And Complexity certainly wants to make another LAN. The Bounty Hunter and the Bane ban out. The Bane ban out is... I guess that makes sense. People want to be able to jump in, don't want to be immediately fiends grouped up. But Cloud9, for them, a support... Again, and this isn't... Also with their lineup now, this is either not a Korlock or it is a Slaughter support or the Darkseer support. We've seen the Darkseer support. I know you guys are going to think this is crazy, but Darkseer support has been run a few times in Europe recently. So both of these teams having really strange drops or uncommon, not strange, just not heroes that get picked in this fashion often.
When you have these dynamics where you level one Roche from the start anyways, like, things get weird, you know? That happened earlier today. Now you've got these teams that are all angry at each other and they want to do something, like, funky and crazy. They know each other well. We see a Shadow Demon last pick. Interesting. Now, this is one of those moments where if you do run a run of Slardar support, that's been run a couple of times, I feel like. You set on up the Slytherin Crush and then follow it up with Gyrocopter getting on top of whoever is going to be played in the offlane position. Here, but also just Shadow Demon in general, a pretty great hero for being able to one have that lockdown, but also the amp damage, keep Doom in one place with that the purge coming out as well.
Yeah, you can also disrupt defensively someone if they're in a bad spot. You're worried they're about to take a sonic wave to the face to defensively disrupt them, especially since it's pretty obvious. And they're going full. Okay, it's like, guys, we want the Doom. Because Doom's really good, and then we'll go full aura, like, range strat. It's kind of an odd build. The Queen of Pain, we can't underestimate how much value she gets. She should win this lane against Warlock. If she doesn't, something has gone wrong, because she has such an advantage with Drow there. Again, though, Complexity, as you've pointed out, they're locked down. Where is it? You got one single target stun.
Yeah. Well, and this is the second thing, the second time that this has happened. Two games in a row with Complexity choosing basically no stuns. I don't know how well it's going to work. They have a lot of synergy here. They have a lot of damage that can come out very swiftly. It is going to end up being SVG on the Slardar with 1437 on the Shadow Demon, Korlock again, and then Ritsu playing that Gyro. Let's actually do a full introduction of these players here as we do end up getting a pause right at the start. Z-Freak is going to be playing the Ventral Spirit for Complexity. We have Chessie on the Queen of Pain. Zizzy is going to be playing on that Drow Ranger. We have Swindle is going to be playing on the Doom. And last but not least, Vlad is going to be playing that defensive support, Mr. Dazzle.
Yeah.
Sean, thank you.
Yeah, so we've got Slaughter already picked up by SVG, so the support Slaughter will be interesting. Gyrocopter on Ritsu again. We've got 1437 on... Oh, thank you, camera. We've got 1437 on the Shadow Demon, is it? Nope, that is going to be him on the Shadow Demon. Sorry, having some slight camera issues getting to the edge there. And Brax on that mid Warlock, and finally MSS on the Darkseer, already TPing, trying to get out an early ward in top lane. So that's going to be something nice for them.
Yes, Shadow Demon here is eating a little bit of the Gyrocopter rockets right in his mouth. A little bit of clipping there as Dr. Robotnik flies on by him. So yeah, it's certainly they're aware of the potential, at least Roshan. Not, I think that we have a little bit of fun banter going back and forth. We'll call it that. It does look like Complexity are trying to leave the base somewhat quickly. Already bought items on several of these heroes and are trying to run on out the door. Several sentry wards picked up, two on the Dazzle, two on Z-Freak, and looks like they're going to come and try and deward down here. They're actually going up top. Okay, so yeah, Cloud9 is going up top. That makes sense.
Yeah, they've sent some folks up there. They're trying to make sure that they get off the early ward and so on, but we don't know where this TP is landing for the Shadow Demon, or is he already... Because MSS is TPing, Shadow Demon is... Where? Oh, he's hiding, sorry. He's next to... I have trouble with my screen seeing that. So I don't think Shadow Demon has decided to port out somewhere. He was just, like, inside the gyrocopter for me, and I'm like, yeah. I'm clicking on you, and I'm getting gyro. So, not sure what's up with that. Yeah, we got some Roshan being pinged a little bit, and I don't think Complexity can do it here as easily. I mean, with Drow Aura minus Alma...
I mean, they know. Cloud9 know what's going on, so I don't think that they go for it. Maybe they do, and Cloud9 just sort of say, we're not even going to go check. Sorry, by the way, to chat real quick. I have a system in place to make sure I don't mess up the overlay. I put a piece of paper over my screen, and I took it away for a second to see, and then that meant that the overlay stayed up. So my bad about that one, but we're all taken care of. It was only anyways.
Piece of paper work? How does that help?
You know what? I'll make a video about it, and I'll put it on my YouTube channel. Excellent. You're going to be impressed.
I will be. I'm really confused, but either way, yeah, I just... I know what you mean now. Okay, I think I understand what you mean. I too understand your trouble with the overlay. I am paranoid about it, so I usually actually cast the last bit of the draft in OBS to make sure nothing goes wrong. But either way, talking about this game, looking at the lineups, Drow lineups are always hard to run. They also kind of peak a bit early. Drow is a hero that's got... She can carry later, but generally people build her in an odd way, trying to maximize for the aura. So it'll be interesting to see what exactly goes down. But as the only carry is really that gyrocopter, and then of course whatever illusions they can make on Cloud9.
30 seconds to battle.
Maybe not something they have to worry about. But if we see Swindle Melons being caught a bit out of position, he's going to take a Slithering Crush, more than enough damage with the Rocket Barrage, and even with that heal, he is going to be our first blood. So Swindle's going down.
Very interesting. You know, I love this Slardar here in this support role, or really just ganking role is I think what this is going to be more of. Like, if you think about the way that Slardar works as a hero, obviously getting the Blink Dagger is great for the initiation, but we've seen him more and more often be played in a role where you get the sprint levels up very quickly. 44% bonus movement speed is enormous. He's going to be running around. Thank you for no, Roshan. He's going to be running around like a race car in these early stages and being really effective in the ganks, I think.
He can also do a lot of work with just the force staff.
Oh yeah, totally.
It feels like if he can't get up the gold for the blink just because he's maybe not the core farmer, making the parts of the force staff totally viable on a slaughter. So we're gonna see if they can get, like you talked about earlier, Disruption, Slithering Crush, Rocket Barrage, you're dead every time.
Mm-hmm. Well, and looks like they're going to bring Eventual Spirit on down into the bottom for a little bit of an ability to break on up that combo that does come out. Top lane, this might be a little bit rough here. Look at all these Ion Shells coming out, and Vlad drops very, very low already. I don't know, despite the fact that they have two ranged heroes that can burst them down, it's still a little bit difficult. Just the natural push power that Darkseer has, it can't be overstated how devastating that can be.
Yeah, it... Also, they don't have the heroes for taking out the Ion Shell creep super easily or for catching out this Darkseer, so this top lane should be... Oh, mid! We have a lot of damage coming out onto Chessie with the Fatal Bonds. Okay, he's not going to go down, but he's going to have to pop his salve shortly. He can actually pop it now. Yeah, I was about to say, there's no creeps being Fatal Bonded up, so you can actually pop it.
Bottom lane, Swindle's dropping low. Oh. A couple more right clicks might be enough. They end up popping him there. Nicely done by the Doom to finish him off. Or Gyrocopter, excuse me. Last right click there, finishing him.
Yeah. Really well done. They're going for a gank on Brax. Z-Freak gonna get out of the way, make sure Brax doesn't see him there, but this lane already going really poorly for Swindle, and he's recently transitioned to offlane, so I think they're taking advantage of the fact that maybe this isn't his most common role, and he's having a bit of trouble, even with the Doom.
I mean, it's just so much pressure being applied. Like, I think that no matter what you go, Disruption versus the little stun coming out, Magic Missile on Z-Freak, and looks like 2 seconds is a little bit better than one. I think that's just 1 second, 1.45, excuse me. It's a dangerous lane just in general. Like, anytime you have a gyrocopter in lane, you're going to be able to be aggressive, whether it would be through, like, a Rubick or some other hero that just can sort of tear you apart. And, oh god, the Invis are now in the Shadow Demon. Swindle should know about this, though, and I don't think that he gets caught here.
Yeah, he's playing way back. He's realized I wouldn't be surprised either if he even just decides to go to the jungle. He is holding a skill point as well to make sure that he...
Top lane, Vlad.
Yeah, Vlad is dead. Goodbye. He's delaying the inevitable, but he's going to go down. And there's no follow-up drow on the wrong side of the trees. She's trying to get around this, but MSS has full ward vision of her. Although he doesn't have another surge for 3 seconds. He's going to pop the salve, though, and I don't think there's much Zizzy can do here. Yeah, frost arrows, not enough. And this is rough.
Yeah, he even just stops on off in the end with for a casual little ion shell before he ends up being brought his soul ring recipe. And everything looking good for this Darkseer so far. He's been able to get it pretty much once, and really, really well done there. Again, Cloud9 looking very strong, and I'm really worried about Complexity and their ability to sustain here. This Korlock, he has been the X factor. I mean, you take a look, 16-2 versus the 14-3, despite the fact that the Queen of Pain right now has, what is this, 82 damage, Brax has still been able to hold his own with only 70.
Yeah, he's doing a really good job harassing Chessie out, and also they decided their Slaughter was potentially thinking about a drive-by on the Quap if she had been out of position at all, because she had gotten really low. These Fatal Bonds are just killing her off time and time again, and I don't know what to say. Brax, I didn't expect him to have a great lane there just because it's a drow Quap, but Quap being... Chessie kind of being destroyed.
Yeah. I wonder if it's worth it, like... Queen of Pain does struggle with sort of the harassment that comes out. I wonder if it'd be worth it for her to go for another null tally just to get a little bit of extra HP in this lane, because that's really the only problem, is she would be able to last hit significantly more effectively if there wasn't that constant danger that she was just going to get taken out and killed. Oh god, bottom lane looks like Swindle is going to be in trouble. They end up getting the disruption down. Creep is going to be tanking all that damage as well. They get the stun. Swindle's dropping low. Can they actually kill him though? He does have two levels in that Scorched Earth, a couple of points down on top of the Shadow Poison, a second Rocket Barrage, and he walks away from this one.
Okay, that was fantastic. I was about to say, they didn't rotate any heroes, and I thought it was a bit of a mistake, but if you can get Swindles out of that alive, you're pretty happy. Albeit, a rotation might have been able to kill off SVG, but it's hard. The Slaughter just sprints away, because again, Complexity has chosen a lineup with some slows, no stuns. I don't know about a secondary Null Talisman on Chessie. I feel like he just needs to be very aggressive with the bottle crowing, and I'm sure it's something Chessie has dealt with before, having rough mid lane, so we'll see how he best decides to adapt to it, and I think he wants a high ground ward.
Yeah, definitely.
Maybe just holding on to that one. He's already got one for the rune. Not quite sure where he wants to put his second ward.
Oh, last hitting. Tough matchup here.
He's winning. Chessie's winning the last hit wars. It's just that he's being harassed a bit more than you would maybe expect. And it's something where, with Chessie's skill as a player, you maybe expect him to have even more at this point. But he hasn't lost the lane. He's just being harassed up the wazoo.
No, totally. Well, Darkseer level 5, top lane, has been able to pick up his soul ring. In terms of net worth, he is not the highest in the world, but relatively even with Doom. We're going to see this pull through here as well. Should be able to be successful, get the Shadow Demon a little bit more of this experience. And does also have a little bit of a stack there. I think this is this a double stack that ended up getting some creeps killed? I think that's what happened here. So Gyrocopter, everything that he wants. Top rune is going to be where the battle's at, though. They're able to get the stun down on top of Z-Freak. That is going to be the Warlock slow coming out as well. Looks like Vlad is going to end up falling. Nice grave, keeping him alive at least for now. Sonic Wave committed. Brax, oh god, the Doom ends up taking him out with that Scorched Earth at the end, and Vlad getting away on nothing.
Can we discuss how Vlad got that Shallow Grave off at literally the last second possible? He was at like 11 health when it went off, and he's playing from Russia on US East? I am mind blown. Like, you generally, when I expect players to do it a bit earlier, right? A lot of the really good dabbles, yes, you leave it till the last second. But factoring in the ping, as Swindle Melons takes a full Rocket Barrage and cooldown, he's probably going to go down here. No Scorched Earth to save him this time. And yeah, I'm just really constantly impressed by Vlad's play. Whether Complexity win this or not, the guy knows his way around Dota.
Oh, absolutely.
And like 400 ping. So,
I mean, that's the thing that's so impressive by some of these is like, you think about how hard it is to just think about the correct time to cast out a spell in general, like, you know, waiting for the exact moment when it's right, and then on top of that, having the added, like, being able to time that out with the ping that you're getting. Anyways, we see MSS move on over into the jungle now. He has had to vacate the lane because of the aggressions that started to be mounted against him.
Yeah, he's still...
Go ahead.
Oh, he's just still having an okay time. He's not maybe getting as much as the Doom, but Doom now headed off to the jungle as well. And MSS, he's got those stacks for him. Wasn't quite sure if he or the Gyro would get them, but turns out MSS, he's going to be getting some sweet, sweet gold. Work towards his mech.
Yeah, that's going to be good. I feel like, again, we've talked about the fact that Complexity don't really have a ton of stuns. I still do believe that Cloud9 are probably going to want to be somewhat aggressive after this mech ends up coming up for Darkseer, if that indeed is what it's going to be. Just because, like we've talked about, only the one real core that can sort of tear apart the enemy team, you want to be able to really make the most of that power curve. And maybe by the time Brax ends up getting his Aghanim, or not even his Aghanims, but, you know, his first couple of ulties up, they can start pushing down tier 1 towers and really make their presence game.
I agree, and I think that they've got a really good team fight lineup, especially if you just play around those big ultimates. You can do the whole, hey, every 100 or so seconds, golems are a bit longer cooldown though, but yeah, you can play around the wall, you can play around the golems, you can maybe do the wall one team fight and wait for the golems the next, or just blow both. You can play around that and just kind of fall back. You've got defensive heroes, you can let SVG or the Shadow Demon potentially tank a gank in between while your cooldowns are down, and just complex. Cloud9 has a really nice lineup for that.
Yeah, totally. All right, well, Queen of Pain, she is definitely going to be the biggest beneficiary of all of this bonus damage that's coming on out, currently hitting for 129 a pop. Considering that this drow ended up going for the double Wraithband strat into the treads as well. So really doubling down on Chessie's ability to carry them through this game. And I think that it's not a bad idea. You know, Quap, if you end up getting a relatively quick level 11, you can start roaming around and maybe getting a kill with somebody else, finding a pickoff if you combo it with Doom. No matter what, Chessie is probably one of the highest DPS heroes in the game right now. Although we do see the rotation now, 1437 as well as Gyrocopter. Also worth noting, the Shadow Demon ended up going for a max Shadow Poison build as opposed to going for more in Soul Catcher, and isn't quite be able to find Swindles there. Really wanted it, not quite in the vision range. And now they're actually a little bit caught out. Well, Dazzle is here, as well as the Doom. And I'm just going to drop a ward and skedaddle on out of here.
Suddenly hard to punish that type of rotation coming out of Cloud9 again, as we say, without the stuns. But Vlad should have had a good idea. Yeah, we've got stuff circled. They're pretty sure where they boarded up. And if Complexity can just push elsewhere, although we do have the TP rotations coming out of the Shadow Demon, they're immediately going in on her. Him, disruption coming out, but can Qualp follow this up? Has the Sonic Wave if she wants to use it. And Chessie getting slowed up, now having the Chaotic Offering, and Chessie's just gonna pop. At the same time, cooldown zoning out Vlad so he can't get in range to Shallow Grave up his core. And that is not what Complexity wanted. Cloud9 pulling a little bit more ahead with this team fight.
Was the Quap silence there? It looked like there was an opportunity for her to blink away.
Yeah, she got Chaotic Offering.
Okay, I thought that after the stun ended up wearing off that they maybe were going to be able to get the quick blink away, but apparently not going to be the case. Zizzy is starting to hit really hard as well. So they still need an ability to get on top of the drow. The golem is great for being able to lay out that stun, and of course, killing off the Queen of Pain is absolutely enormous as well. But I think they're still in a decent area right now. Like, you have the big ultimates coming out from Cloud9, you have the damage that's coming out from Complexity, and that's going to be able to tear down these towers very quickly. And as soon as these big ultimates are off of cooldown, you know, there's the chance to jump in here again.
We have another cooldown in mid, and the Shallow Grave immediately out from Vlad, but he is most likely dead regardless. And yeah, the upheaval, he just can't walk away. He even pops his wand. They managed to use the magic missile, but Ritsu, he's not taking any damage. And so, once again, Complexity not able to fight here. Chessie, again, he has up Sonic Wave and so on, just nothing he can do, and they're losing top tower at the same time.
This is rapidly becoming a problem that Complexity doesn't have a great solution for. Even with the Doom on up, they haven't been able to find the rotations that they've needed to find these kills. There is going to be a jump on top of SVG. They don't have to commit Doom to this, I don't think, considering you've got Chessie here as well. SVG, oh no! Esther.
Yep. Well played, though.
Oh, really well played. Very well played.
unfortunate for Chessie, who's not having the game of his life, but this can still all turn around. They just need some good pickoffs from Complexity. They certainly have a lineup where they can find individuals and kill them off. And if they can do that to the key heroes like the Warlock, like the Darkseer, which are going to be the playmakers until Gyro gets online, you've got something going. You're buying yourself time for the Drow, who's going Morbid Mask, maybe early Roshan.
Yeah. Certainly a possibility. They've got the damage to be able to do it, actually. This is a nice little dynamic with their lineup, is pretty much with just these two, I think that they're going to be able to take it very, very swiftly. And Aegis is certainly going to help, and I don't think that Cloud9 are going to be able... Oh, wait a minute. All right, they're smoked on up. If they... Okay, they're going into the jungle. They're not going to be able to find Roche, thankfully. Wait, maybe? Oh god, they know they're pinging it out. I think that they're going to be able to find this one. They do end up popping it. The salve is already committed for Zizzy. What are you doing, Ritsu? Run in there. Oh, they don't do it. They're going to be going for the fight down here in the bottom. SVG is going to land the stun on top of Vlad, but I think that he is going to be able to TP out. No, vacuum committed in the end. Now
he's just buying them time. Like, right, Vlad purposely, I think... He knows there's a vacuum up, and he knows he's not actually going to get the TP out, but he's like, I need to make them waste their time here so that we get the Roshan. So really well played.
I don't know if Cloud9 knew about that. I feel like they didn't. Otherwise, they would have turned on in and just called down on top of the Rosh pit.
Yeah. I think Ritsu had an idea, but as you said, wasn't quite sure about wanting to use that. Maybe was hoping he'd cut off other people. And maybe they're not even that worried on Cloud9. Yeah, Zizzy got himself up the Aegis, but they might just be able to gank them here if Slaughter can get in at all. He's going on to Z-Freak. The silence, though, and the magic missile saving his life, but now here comes the disruption. He can't fight into that. Where is the backup? They're slowing up Slaughter again, but there's lots of poison going out, and now a cooldown's going to be landing on top of their heads. Vlad's again trying to save the day, but he is going to go down. It looks like the swap coming out. Zizzy is using that first life. Vlad has already used the shallow grip of himself, and Chessie is being blown up here. Why isn't he blinking away? He's got the blink on cooldown, but he wants a big sonic wave. There it is, with the scream, he finishes off Ritsu, but now Zizzy is gonna fall for a second time. They should be able to just auto-attack down MSS. Swindle Melon's on the back lines, he's fighting up against the Golem, and the Golem's winning. But at least this team fight won finally in favor, I would argue, given all things, for the lineup of Complexity.
What a great just ability to hold on to that skill. Chessie, knowing the absolute limits that he can push this hero to, that was so impressive. Like you said, that's chance to blink away, instead opting to turn, toss on out that sonic wave, and just tear him apart. Really great play there by that Queen of Pain. Some of the best that I've seen in a while. And Swindles as well, coming in at the last second there, able to level on out the Doom. And while it wasn't a convincing teamfight win, the triple kill for the Queen of Pain means that I think Complexity are back in this game. Oh god, Vlad does get to Crave himself yet again. No TP this time, and this is certainly going to be a dead dazzle. Oh man. There it is, one last right click. Blink Dagger on the Doom. That was a Midas picked up on the Warlock. And one last item that I ended up missing. Helm of the Dominator on Drow.
Yeah,
I still think that right now Cloud9 are in the sort of driver's seat.
They're definitely in the driver's seat, and I feel like they have the easier lineup to execute. Complexity's team fights need to be so perfect. They need so much more on the Drow Ranger. It's rough, but if they can get some good engagements like the Lost One they just did, even though it was an even trade because they were behind, it was certainly better for them. I think they can do some work. And Chessie, we saw him in the first game of the series. He was a pickoff monster. Let's see if he can do anything bottom. Actually, the stun, did I see that right? Z-Freak used it on the creep in hopes that MSS wouldn't kill him. But here comes Chessie. Does Chessie have the auto attacks? Looks like MSS has overstayed his welcome. And a nice little... Oh, we have a Doom coming out as well. Braxy's doomed up. He's trying to wander away, but the Warlock, he's not exactly a fast hero. They should be able to get this kill. Unfortunately, they lose Zizzy in the top lane. At least they're going to get some decent trade. Yes, you lost your hard carry, but you got two cores for it, so I think you're going to be okay with that.
Across the map, just things going everywhere.
Yeah.
Well done there to be able to find the pickoff. That was just a smoke that came on out at the same time for the Shadow Demon as well as the Slaughter. They did both have TPs, but Shadow Demon's was on cooldown, and I think that, like you said, it's worth it for them to go for that kill on the Drow while the sort of engagement is going on down in the bottom lane. And off the back of this Complexity, you're going to be able to take a tower. I think that every trade that they get, going to be taking it. They want to be able to delay this game as long as possible and just keep the aggression off of them.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Yeah. I'm Something interesting, I think, here that's happening when we're talking about aggression. The vengeful, oh goodness, we have an engagement. Sonic Wave comes out. Chessie just needs to be able to scream in 4 seconds. Vlad's here. Vlad's gonna save you, Chessie. He's always got your back. And now Chessie blinks up and gets the Shadow Demon as well, who had a mega kill streak because 1437 doing work. But Chessie's here and gonna have that Orchid up. And yeah, again, another game where he had a rough start. He's bringing the work. We were talking about aggression, though. I feel like the vengeful spirit swap may be kind of the answer to Zizzy getting up, people getting up in his face. I'm not sure.
Yeah, we'll see.
They've done it once, but then unfortunately he was still in the, what's it called, upheaval, and didn't really manage to quite get out of the upheaval. It's very strong.
Yeah, it's a difficult spell to be able to work around. I mean, just such a huge AoE in general, and I mean, I want to go back again to that tier 2 fight that we ended up seeing up here. The fact that they were able to drop down the golems as well as the gyrocopter ulti is pretty big, but they were still able to come out of that one even for complexity, just because of, I think, Chessie's really strong play, making sure that he wasn't in the middle of all of it. You saw that complexity was very spread out, and the one key thing that they need to keep in mind is their positioning in these team fights. It's very hard for them to push high ground because there's always going to be the option for the vacuum into the Warlock ulti, into the, on top of that, the cooldown. So there's never going to be a position where they feel safe. There's never going to be a position where they can let up their guard. But also Complexity realized this, and we're probably going to see both sides try and play around that. Maybe going for some, you know, animation canceling or whatever, or trying to bait out ulties. But really, it's going to be just timing around these ulties for looking for their initiation.
Oh, we have the blink up on Swindle Melons, immediately the Chaotic Offering, and let's see if there's any sort of stun. Both sides have used their big ults. Vlad now putting the weave on the back lines, but the Golem may just do some work on Swindles. Looks like he's going to be fine, but it's Vlad who's caught out of position by SVG. Amp damage on him and everything. Shallow Grave has come out, but where is the rest of Complexity? Doesn't look like they want to fight, and they're sacrificing Vlad once again. All things considered, probably Complex. Oh goodness, what is Swindle doing so close to? He's just farming. That is a life choice. I wouldn't be this. Yeah, I wouldn't be that ballsy. But I think all things considered, only losing Vlad, they're pretty good. Unfortunate that they couldn't get more. And this is a different Golem than last time, I'm pretty sure.
He tricks them out each match. Apparently the other ones weren't doing the job, and this time he's going to bring in somebody else. So Chessie, Orchid, now going to be able to pick on up the Ogre Club. I'm imagining that this is going to be into a BKB. It just feels like that type of game where they need to have that sort of untarget ability coming out for him. If he gets locked down in these fights, I think that Complexity just lose. It's maybe not quite at that range, but you kind of feel like Complexity are hanging on by a thread at this point, despite the fact that they're actually ahead in terms of net worth. One bad fight and it's all over. It's just you have the potential for the team wipe so quickly. I don't know. I'm really concerned about Complexity's ability to sort of sustain through this draft, but they've been able to make a good show of it. I mean, you take a look at what they've been bringing to the table. Now Chessie with the Invis rune as well as the DD, they've been finding the pickoffs that they've needed. They're going to smoke on up now and try and move on in and find another pickoff here. And if they get the initiation on top of maybe the Darkseer, get the silence down on him, I mean, there's no Guardian Greaves, there's no way to purge this off at this point. This might be an opportunity for them to really take advantage.
We definitely saw, as you said in the first game, oh good. Okay, I'm having now Dota issues. The Chessie's, can you see Chessie's hero?
I can barely.
Yeah, right? I mean, that's
it's invis, but
it's invis, but not normally invis. Yeah, not normally meant to be that invis. And we've got a Doom on the back line. Sonic Wave comes out, actually catches two, and Chessie, he's in a bit of trouble at the same time. Can they kill up anybody in the back lines? This weird wraparound team fight from Complexity may be working out. The wall is dropped, but the Darkseer is dead, and now Spindle Melons, he manages to kill off the Gyrocopter. They've somehow won this team fight for Complexity. Are they gonna pick up SVG? Just two supports running around, 1437. He is in the danger zone, but they level death him. I thought for sure he'd get that TP off, but looks like no. And yeah, my heroes are rapidly disappearing, so good thing it's like the last game in the set, because my hero portraits all just disappeared, along with Chessie in that invis being actually invisible, other than his name to me. But either way, a really nice wraparound from Complexity, and we were just saying how this game feels like it's hard for them, making more and more space, and they can certainly take towers fast with the Drow Aura.
Yeah, they're about to completely tear through this lineup. I mean, this is at least going to be a tier 2 tower. I don't know if they can take more off the back of it, but Roche about to respond. They're going to be able to take that. A lot of the teamfight ulties were committed as well. The Chaotic Offering, thankfully not, but they did end up using the wall. Vacuum there also. It's going to respond as soon as they walk in. Yep, there's Z-Freak. Hey, Roshan, how you doing? They're going to take this guy right now, no questions asked. But I think the biggest play there was by Z-Freak being able to bring Chessie on down to the low ground, because the right clicks are the probably biggest damage dealers at this point in time for complexity. Like, obviously, great Sonic Wave, it's wonderful, but just being able to have Drow continue to hit away and Queen of Pain continually hit away is just so important. So, I think that the fact that Venge was able to bring him on down and then follow it up with the stun, they weren't able to target the player that they wanted to target, and Drow just hidden away. If you let this hero right-click you, you're going to lose a fight.
Yeah, really well played by Complexity in that last engagement. I also have to say the initiation from behind, very smart. And just getting a lot of good work done for their lineup. Now, Chessie, as you said, BKB up. I wouldn't be surprised if it's a sheep stick next, trying to get the pickoffs on the heroes like Darkseer and so on before they get the jump. You've got a lot to deal with, though. If you don't get the Shadow Demon, he might save someone. The Slaughter, of course, has that huge AoE Slithering Crush and a smoke coming out of C9.
Well, they want to try to really use their lineup to their maximum potential here, and it does look like they kind of have an idea of where everybody is. It's interesting that they're going to go for this one, considering Aegis was just used, but I think, oh god, they're all grouped together. They're going to drop on down the Weave. Looks like actually Complexity is expecting this, and they might try and turn this back around here. Manta is up on Drow, so going to be able to at least create a little bit more damage from the illusions that are there. Oh god, this is going to come down so much to the initiation. Chessie is the hero that ends up getting caught out at the very start. Doom is caught up in a bubble now, maybe going to be able to drop it down. The Sonic Wave hits onto a heck of a lot of heroes, but it looks like Gyrocopter might not fall. Huge vacuum, but where's the wall? It's already been committed one time. Heroes are dropping left and right, but it's mostly Cloud9 as everybody is going down. We see Queen of Pain now with an ultra kill. They're all freeing dead, and now we're going to be seeing a tier 1 tower fall. Oh, Complexity just showing how to make the team fights happen. 4,000 gold swing at the end of all of it, and they're just gonna saunter on down this top lane, be comfortable, and they might be knocking Cloud9 out of another tournament here for the second time in one day.
I didn't quite catch that, but the wall either came off cooldown right as that fight was ending. Like, he had it 2 seconds maybe after that beautiful vacuum, and it just wasn't the right timing. And they're gonna get a Rax off of this. This is the push lineup. We could see some buybacks, but I think they're just gonna try to wait it out. They're at least losing their melee Rax. I think Complexity will Rax and back, and actually the Drow Illusions, yeah, they switch over to the correct Rax, and they are all now running away. So huge win for Complexity, and they've all gotten out cleanly, assuming that SVG doesn't actually manage to catch anyone out.
So, I mean, right now, Warlock ulti is on cooldown. Cooldown is back on up, as is the vacuum wall. I guess that's the thing, is the vacuum wall being back up. It's probably a little bit too greedy, and Complexity now are feeling comfortable. After winning that fight, the onus is on that, is on Cloud9 to make something happen. And that last team fight, they tried to do that, and they just weren't able to execute enough. I think that it was just bit of a too awkward of an engagement. Chessie blinking aggressively to the other side of all of these ultis getting dropped meant that they were able to really take the team fight that they wanted, and not everybody was getting caught. They split perfectly by Complexity. Chessie is not afraid, by the way.
Yeah, I mean, he's got a big streak. He doesn't care if he gives them 10,000,000 gold. He actually might, yeah, burn the Aegis there, but as we saw, he's probably fine with that. He only had about a minute and a half on it, so thinking it's worth it, and they can now go for this tier 2 push if they feel like it. Is he actually continuing to go, and he might just, oh, he pops his BKB, he wants to go for this, and this disruption is just gonna set it up perfectly for him. Chessie does have to be a little bit careful, but he gets the damage, and I'm really surprised he bothered to BKB for that, but I think Cloud9 just feeling like, not Cloud9, Complexity feeling like they can really crush the spirits and the rest of Cloud9 here by picking off those supports.
God, what a... It's just, I want to be Chessie. That was really impressive. I want to be Chessie. I want to be able to play Dota like this. This is awesome. He just doesn't even care. Ran on up under the high ground. There very easily could have been the rest of Cloud9 right behind that Shadow Demon. And he just ran on up there, BKB, and so he knew that his team was going to be behind him. Looking really solid. I mean, net worth chart, what can we say? 15K over the course of roughly roughly 6 minutes. Experience as well, right around 16,000. It's not looking good for Cloud9. My expert analysis.
Complexity is back in the driver's seat, most certainly. At the same time, they do have, Cloud9 has one of those powerful heroes in the Darkseer who can turn your strengths against you, and Gyrocopter. Yes, Flat Cannon is only 6 shots every 30 seconds, but if you really need to, you can always rapier up and then you're defending all the things. You still have to be very careful with that. Either way, we have got Cloud9 coming out of their base, poking their heads out, and just gonna farm their jungle a little bit, and some sneezing in the background, which you may or may not have heard.
Don't worry, it's all fine. Everybody's nobody noticed. It's all
exactly
good.
We've got a gem out on the Venge as well. I really like this, using the Wave of Terror to make sure that she's checking for all of those D wards. And full Complexity, for any team having the map vision, it puts them in a great position to get solo pickoffs. Cloud9's at the stage where I think they have to do the risky thing, like farming outside of their base a little bit to win, so Complexity might be able to take advantage of that and catch somebody out.
Yeah, certainly. Let's take a look at items real quick, because that's going to be another key component. Warlock, I think, is probably just, he needs to get that extra 700 gold, finish on off that Aghanim Scepter. That's a game changer. Okay, it's a pause. Great time to talk about items then. So Shadow Demon Force Staff, the Darkseer hasn't been able to finish off his Greaves, ended up going for the Blink Dagger instead. They need to be able to have him have the initiation. Like, they have to follow that up and then be able to lay down the stun on top of it, because if they don't catch, like, pretty much consistently, we've seen either the Warlock ulti hit onto two, we've seen the Vacuum Wall hit onto two, or the Calldown hit onto two, but never really more than that. And that's really what their lineup relies upon, because all of these heroes are balanced around hitting lots of heroes with their ultimates. And you see the right-click damage that comes out from Complexity. You talked about how it's hard to measure the impact. That's really the impact, is that if you drop down all these ultis and they don't hit, if the positioning is good and solid from Complexity, they're going to be able to survive the initial salvo and then just rip you to pieces. So I think that they need to find that big team fight where they can turn it all back around.
The positioning, with the help of Quap being very maneuverable and the Ventral Spirit, has been really good on Complexity after the first initial fights, because they definitely had trouble earlier on. Quap going in on Brax. Brax is dead. Quap has a DD. Of course she does. Brax, this time last game, already had the Ags, was well, like, I think he was... Well, first of all, the game had ended, but Brax was also, almost done with his refresher, and he doesn't even have the Ags yet this time.
He also doesn't have buyback right now. So even if he did have the capability of doing it, because he's been building all these components, they're in a position where they can push high ground for 25 seconds. What are you going to do against this? They're ready to go.
Yeah, and it looks like it could be at least a tier 3. They still do need to be careful on Complexity, as we've talked about. There's a lot of wombo combo coming out, and the Gyrocopter, he is getting more and more farm, but it's not maybe going to be enough. If they can get a big vacuum, some good flat cannon off, here comes MSS, big vacuum wall coming out. There's going to be a call down, a BKB from Chessie. The supports might die, but Chessie does not care, and Z-Freak actually swaps in Vlad. Zizzy's just going to TP out. There's finally, the Chaotic Offering comes out a little too late, and once again, the Sacrificial Lamb being Vlad. Whether this they can find anybody else is highly doubtful, and never mind.
Z-Freak, they saw him for a second there with the Shadow Poison, but weren't able to react quick enough. That would have been a huge kill, just not quite able to be quick enough on the fingers, or maybe the cast point was a little bit too long on those spells. Regardless, 1100 gold swing is all that they're going to be getting from committing Vacuum, Wall, and Warlock ulties, and now Chessie on the hunt yet again with the Shiva's Guard as well as this Orchid. If they separate, create any separation at all, Cloud9, a member of their team, is going to get picked apart here.
Yeah, so going to be, they're trying to use the Golem to push a little bit for Cloud9. They've also, look at these deep wards by Complexity. Cloud9's not in a great position to get a gem up, but it's certainly something you want, maybe in a little bit. Their supports, though, pretty starved, and part of the issue, yeah, you've got your Blink Dagger up on the Slaughter, but he's not someone who can farm terribly well. Shadow Demon at least can try to take stacks or something with that Shadow Poison, not the best usage either, but these deep, deep wards from Complexity give them everything they need to know for the next siege.
I mean, yeah, this high ground ward, it's like that right there on its own is potentially game winning. The fact that they're going to be able to have vision as they siege the tower. You'd expect them to be able to come on out and drop something here, but they're going to be able to see everything. There's no sentries dropped on down, which I don't know, maybe they just didn't expect that they were going to be dropping a ward, or they thought that they would have been able to see it, but regardless, it feels like a bit of an oversight, and Complexity are very, very capable of taking advantage of this.
Yeah, they also might just poke at the tower. Oh, we have an engagement. Another nice wall vacuum combo, but it's not enough in the cooldown that you've talked about. It's hitting on, I mean, Swindle with a BKB. He doesn't care. He's actually sharing a bit of damage, but it's going to be just fine. And they might just back out for the Roshan here. It's a nice way to reset the team fight. Wait for your BKBs to be on cooldown and get yourself a second life.
Another 82 seconds before the next wall is going to be back up, and they are ready to go. They did end up getting either the ward expired or eventually did end up getting dewarded there. So no vision of the high ground. Actually, they might be looking to try and catch somebody here. Z-Freak force staffed off to the side. It does look like Zizzy might be the one that's caught out now. Hasn't used the swap quite yet. If they need to do it, Z-Freak can still make that happen. But Plexi playing very conservative now, making sure that they're able to all get out together. Draw Ranger now working on the Eagle Song, has already completed it. Might be going into, probably definitely going to be going into a Butterfly, but I think that Buyback is definitely more worth it at this point.
Not sure how worried the lineup of Complexity is about that. The sieging power from Cloud9, it's certainly there, but as long as it's not the top lane, they don't have to worry about Arax. They probably are fine burning through tier 2s. And that is the quick Roshan that Complexity can do, and Ritsu is already TP'd home, trying to defend their high ground. They need a good Slithering Crush. They need really lucky Fatal Bonds. I feel like when you combine Fatal Bonds with Vacuum Wall combo, you should be able to be doing a lot of damage, but it's just not coming out, and especially since Complexity is starting to have BKBs up on a lot of people, and Doom Refresher.
Yeah, that's the game-winning item right there. Yeah. Are able to actually get it off, which I don't see why they wouldn't be able to. The BKB on Doom is 9 seconds right now, so that was the first one that we ended up seeing in that last fight. And if you're able to take apart, you know, any one of, honestly, all of the targets for Cloud9 are great Doom targets, with the exception of, I was gonna say Slaughter, but honestly all of them, every single one of them needs to be able to cast their spells. Are we gonna finally see the end right now to this very long series that we've been seeing? Veeve is gonna be dropped down on top of Complexity. They also end up throwing out the Solar Crest on top of Zizzy. They're gonna wait for the Vacuum Wall on back in the background. Now we have Cloud9 doing a lot of damage. Look at everybody fall. Complexity is getting completely and totally torn apart. They do get off one of the Dooms on top of the Dark Tier. He's already used his spells. They chase on forward now on top of the Slaughter, and this might end up being their swan song. I think that at this point in time, Complexity are still kind of okay with trying to take on out these barracks. Chessie is certainly not afraid of anything that's going on. BKB is finally popped, and now they're going to have to make their retreat.
Oh, Zizzy, I don't know if you're getting out of there. He's vacuumed back, he's auto-attacked down, he's going to try to work on the ranged Rax, the one which doesn't regen. And yeah, there's the vacuum wall combo we were talking about needing to see with the Fatal Bonds. It melted everyone. Chessie managed to get a kill on the Slaughter, and Swindlemelon's actually got off both Dooms, one onto Doxia, one onto Gyrocopter. It wasn't enough because the combos had already come out, and that's one of the downsides of Doom. But a fantastic hold from Cloud9, earning themselves a good amount of gold back, even though they're 20,000 net worth behind, showing that they still can fight.
Absolutely. And vacuuming creeps, why not? If you're feeling comfortable with it, go for it. So 20k net worth, they can still, I mean, we've talked about this a lot in this draft. There's never going to be a situation where Complexity can rest on their laurels. They've got to keep up the aggression. This is going to finish off the Warlock ulti with his Aghanim Scepter now. Not quite level 3, it's worth noting. It's only level 14, so to get that level 3 up in a little bit. Doom did end up using the refresher, so 110 seconds where that's going to be back up. You kind of want to be able to make the pressure happen again, though. With the Warlock ulti down for another 75 seconds, we'll see if Complexity try and go yet again. Maybe waiting for Drow to be back up. Oh, off to the side here. Shadow Demon, living life dangerously. Going to need to get out of here, and he has been able to get that gem back up as well.
They stole the gem.
Yeah.
Yeah, they managed to get it off in that engagement, and this is really helpful. We can see them already. He's going to, yep, go for the D ward using the poison. Feeling pretty good about himself, most likely, but at the same time, they see all of this. So, yeah, he's not actually able to get the D ward, and the lineup of Complexity, realizing they have to be more careful with their positioning, will probably just end up leaving Z-Freak in the back lines to save people who are in a pickle or throw up the Glimmer Cape.
So Chessie has a Satanic, by the way.
Yeah, Chessy builds. I actually asked their manager in between the games when you mentioned the Manta, and apparently Chessy just really likes the Manta. He thinks it's really cool to dodge stuff. So that's probably what happened. But Zizzy, he is showing no fear. Even Glimmer caped up under a sentry. That's not how that works. And Swindlemelon jumps in. There's the Doom. There's no wall because of it. This is fantastic for the lineup of complexity. Can they do this? The BKB onto Brax, not on Brax. It's not being doing much with Ritsu, and Chessy now pops his as well. They got the racks. They may just back for complexity.
They also got the buyback by the Darkseer immediately. He ended up going down in that one, apparently. How did that buyback work? He bought back earlier. Of course, that makes more sense. So he got back, got in the middle of the fray, tossed on out that, and really solid Doom as well to make sure that that ended up being a little bit of a combo breaker. 15 seconds before Refresher is back up. At this point in time, do you think it's worth it to wait for double, or do you try and just go with one of them to finish it off quickly?
You know you've got quite a bit of time on the Roshan at the very least. I think that you now having three Raxes down, albeit, and you've got a melee in mid, so instead of it being the range, you might just kind of poke at bottom. I think a lot of it's going to depend on the calls that Chessy makes, whether he thinks that he's ready to go, and whether the Drow Ranger is feeling safe enough. I don't see them being super close to any big item. Swindle actually has a crap ton of money. I'm not quite sure what his next pickup's going to be.
Yeah, that Doom, he is definitely made for getting money. I think definitely buyback is worth saving for, and with only 1600 surplus, ooh, he jumps away from that one, not wanting to get caught out here. With actually no ward vision, but just a little bit of spidey senses tingling. Saw that nobody was on the map, wanted to make sure he didn't end up getting caught out. All of the ultis are going to be back up off cooldown, and this is only going to come down to execution, essentially. We can talk about net worth lead all we want, we can talk about Raxes all we want, and while Complexity certainly are in the position where they can take the fights that they wish to take, there's always the chance. One big team fight and then everybody runs down mid. We've seen stranger things happen, and I mean, only one glyph is up for these guys, and they're going to want to save it.
It's also something where if you're the lineup of Cloud9, all of these fights, everything keeps getting better and better for you for the Darkseer. We've already talked about him replicating heroes. You're getting the Vlads from the Dooms. You're getting the damage aura from Venge, who's now at level 14, so that is maxed out. You're getting Drow's aura for your ranged heroes. Like, there's just a lot of good stuff that you're stealing here, and I think nobody's gone on AC yet, and I'm not quite sure if that's why. Maybe Swindles will just buy a full one because he's getting close to being rich enough to do that. So we'll be interesting. But the rest of Complexity, grouping up bottom, seeing what they can do.
Just rat time. Time to keep on pushing in these lanes. Wait until Roshan ends up popping on up again, and then they take him on out, move on out for the last final push. I would expect to see probably an engagement in the near future to do what they can to secure the Roshan. And I think that if Complexity find a pickoff, which they're very capable of doing, that's going to be very easy. But probably not going to be any more action for the next, I don't know, maybe want to say 3 or 4 minutes. Maybe two. Maybe we'll see it in a couple of minutes here. But Chessy is going to need to be the one that finds out one of these heroes and hopefully is able to burst them down. And again, we're sitting looking at a Quap who's top of the net worth. This guy really knows how to play this hero.
Yeah, it's someone that he's very comfortable with. Another nice thing for the lineup of Complexity, of course, is as you push in all the waves, you can farm your opponent's jungle, really cut off their item progression. And that's part of the reason we still see, even though Cloud9 finally took a favorable engagement a little while ago, the net worth difference and experience is still continuously going towards Complexity because Cloud9 doesn't have anywhere to farm that they feel is super safe. So going to be seeing a few more item pickups. I wonder MKB, what...
up on the gyro in a second, I think.
Yeah, being forced into that, it's not bad by any means. It's still a good source of damage. I'm not sure whether he would have tried to go for something crazier. Actually, maybe an MKB. Are you sure
it's
an
MKB? Rapier.
Exactly. Because he's also got to worry about buyback. He needs like 1,500 more gold if he wants to have buyback and have this. But it's certainly something where the safe play is the MKB, of course. Unfortunately, you're at a point in the game. I think he does have to go the MKB just because evasion's a bitch and there's a solar crest as well. But yeah. Evasion sucks. But it's something where I think you make the safe play here, you still lose the game.
Yeah, totally. No, it's
just slowly.
I agree. Like, they're sort of just being whittled down slowly over time. And if you get an Aegis now, honestly, Drow can just throw her illusions onto the barracks over and over again, especially this ranged one. And it's slowly going to get whittled away. I don't expect them being able to really take one of these. They do go on the Doom illusion, but it is just that, an illusion sent there for scouting purposes. Nothing really of real consequence there. Also worth noting, Doom has a cheese on him. So if you want to sit the Drow just pushing up the high ground slowly, can feed the cheese to either the Drow or the Queen of Pain, depending upon who ends up getting low. And there's going to be the rapier time, peanut butter rapier time, as we see him go for it. Is going to leave it in the base, though, not wanting to reveal this, and just going to keep it on the chicken for now.
He's doing funky things with it. I'm not quite sure what the... Like, why he had... Yep, he puts it in the base. So I think this is a... No, I agree. I understand what you... Like, it's funny, totally. But it's the whole, I want to make sure nobody sees me with it, but I have it easy to pick up. Maybe not even on the courier, because the courier might have to fly out somewhere.
Yeah, it's going to need to be... This is the play where if I was playing, I would just, like, forget about it, run into the battle, you know, all guns blazing, look back, oh, right, there's a rapier on the ground. My bad, guys. But obviously, players are capable of microing.
Okay, so I could be completely wrong here. Vlad definitely pinged out the mid lane. It could have just been like, hey, guys, they're there. It's entirely possible that somebody had called gyrocopters building an MKB. And then when they saw it missing, saw the Demon Edge missing, maybe somebody said something. But that could be crazy talk. I don't know how easy it is for these folks at this level. I mean, Complexity is in control of this game, so it makes sense to me that the supports could be just poking around looking for these types of plays.
They should know that this is a capability, something that could come up. And it's definitely like, I mean, obviously you're making a little bit of light of it. You think about a rapier in the middle of this lineup, even if you do have the evasion on the Drow Ranger, if you've got fatal bonds on top of all of these heroes, they're all going to melt to the rapier damage. So I think that this is potentially game winning, and also going to be able to just, you know, tear apart the enemy complexities, that is, their towers if they get in range of them. So I'm concerned about their ability moving into this next team fight that they maybe underestimate the damage that's going to be coming out from Cloud9.
Yeah, we'll see. We've already seen one big vacuum fatal bonds combo doing mad work, stealing all those good auras. I think if the Venge plays back, they should be fine because they're not going to be able to steal that damage aura, but who knows. But with a secondary cheese, another Aegis, who actually is cheese carrier? It's going to be Quap carrying the cheese. Zizzy has that Aegis, probably feeling good and ready to go. They also, the buyback stat is starting to get super important for both teams, because I think we are at the point, especially with a rapier on the deck, whoever wins the team fight can take a tower or three. We've got a lot of buybacks on Complexity and only two on Cloud9.
Well, let's think about it here. So you've got the Aegis. You've got the Aegis up on the Drow Ranger. You also have the Satanic up on Chessie. You have two cheeses, one on Chessie as well as another one up on the Doom. And buybacks abound. Like this, they've got a lot of potential to get back into it, but no boots of travel. So while they can get back into the fight or they can defend, this is going to definitely be a defining moment in this game as to whether or not they're going to be able to take the team fight that they want. They do end up getting the weave down defensively, trying to keep Zizzy alive a little bit more. Is going to manta off all of this danger. Can't manta off the soul catcher, obviously, but just can wait that out for a second. Creates a couple of illusions of himself as well. Why you hitting yourself is what he ends up saying. Tier 3 tower is starting to fall. Look at the damage these Drow auras do. Yeah. It's just ridiculous.
Always really nice to have, really nice to steal, and let's see if they can get the tower with this. The other thing... Okay, Gyro is now holding it. He's trying to play backwards, but I'm pretty sure they know about this on the lineup of Complexity. Sundermelons also has the jump. He has a lot of different things he can use there, and the Lotus Orb, that's what Vlad bought, so now he doesn't have buyback.
And this is going to be it. Like, this is going to be that moment in time. Are they going to be able to make it happen? Oh. The Lotus Orb, nicely done, able to create that. That's going to be the call down on top of all of them. Vacuum Wall going to catch on to several. They get the Doom off in the end, but is it going to be onto the proper target? Darkseer ended up being the one that got it. A second Doom following it up, going to be able to go onto Warlock. That's not going to be any ulties coming out from him. He actually did end up dropping him still. All right, Gyrocopter ends up falling. Divine Rapier on the ground. They're going to be able to take this one. Because they're looking good.
That's
there
it.
Is another buyback. Who took it? Queen of Pain has it. All right, yeah, those are barracks gone. This is gonna be mega creeps.
And that's their GG Colt. Yeah, they can't recover from losing the rapier. So a nice job from Team Complexity. They have knocked C9 out of two tournaments in a row. We got some shout outs. I like that type of thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow, that was a game.
It was such a, I mean, you sort of think about this. After that one big team fight up there in the top lane, Complexity took the lead, never looked back. They were just constantly applying that pressure. They made sure that they, you know, dotted all their T's and crossed all their I's. That's not how that goes, but it's fine. And they were just able to sort of wear them down slowly over time. And in the one last team fight, being able to get the Doom off on those key targets, just really greatly done overall. Any final thoughts here? As we do end up seeing Cloud9 get knocked out of this tournament, Complexity are going to move on and face Digital Chaos next.